Happy to talk to you. Thank you very much for giving us of your time during your lunch break to watch us. That's fantastic news. Exactly why we do this, everyone. Now, who knows what these hyenas are going to do? Maybe they'll go back towards a den site.
11 den?
There is apparently a den site somewhere around this area. There's another road there. Now, of course, I'm exploring many of these areas for the first time, the same way that you are, everyone. So, Jason, you're wondering about their calls and whether they act differently in the nighttime. Well, I mean, I've never seen a Mara hyena. Well, I have once, but they seem to behave in much the same way that ours do. But in many parts of East Africa, you know, they hunt even more than the lions do, and probably especially down when they're calving. Around here, however, there's so much to scavenge that I suspect they're largely scavenging. Now, we're driving on. They're walking on a path. I don't know if you're able to make that out. But they're basically driving on a well-worn path, and I wonder if this doesn't lead to their den site. If it doesn't, it will probably be some kind of an elephant path. So let's keep following them. This is just fantastic. Now, we don't often follow hyena off-road at Juma, and that is largely because they don't tolerate the vehicles being mobile and crashing through the bushes behind them, as many of the other cats do. But these chaps, because we're able to drive through some open areas, perhaps they're just going to let us keep following them. Also, so many people have done a huge amount of research on the hyenas of this area that it might be that they'll just put up with us. Look at them going there. Every time I see a little termite mound, I think maybe. This is fantastic. This is exactly why we wanted to come out here. Well, essentially we want to see lions hunt, but this is pretty good. We'll go back to those lions just now. We'll let them digest a bit of their food. Hello, Susan in the Netherlands. You want to know if there are big termite mounds here, like there are in South Africa. There aren't, no. There are low ones. There are no doubt just as many termites, but Macrotermes natalensis, which is the big fungus-growing termite that makes all those great big castles of clay at Juma, they don't occur here as far as I'm aware. And also, termites are not huge fans of what we call black cotton soils. I'm just going to stop here in case it's us that's making them run. And these are largely black cotton soils, which means they don't produce the same kind of soil, sandy soils on the ridge crests, that the granitic soils up at Juma do. I think they've found something, or maybe they thought they had. Now, I cannot see them at all with my naked eye. It's quite interesting. Only Jandre has got sight of them, and you, of course. Are they there? To the left. There they are. They're searching for something, you know. Let's see what they're going to find. Maybe just around this next corner. And of course, hyenas, wonderful animals to be telling stories about once you get to know them, because they are so very individual, and the clan hierarchies are so fascinating to watch as they unfold. I think these are youngsters with one big female. I think she is in front of them. There they're jogging away. I'm going to keep my distance. I'm not going to try and catch up with him. All right, while they go around that bush, we'll see if we can keep up to them. Let's head across to the Birmingham Boys with Jamie Patterson.
There is nothing quite like the sight of a massive male lion walking straight down the road towards you. There's something else coming. What is it? It's a lioness. Oh, here she comes. She's actually trotting towards us. Now, I've just come around the corner and encountered the lionesses and their cubs, so I immediately moved past them so that I could get myself into a position where we could turn off all the lights and then the IR and then reposition. They gave me such a surprise. They were right next to us on the road. But as we continued on a little bit further along the road, we came upon the scene in front of us. There was one lioness running along the road. She then turned around and batted one of the males. I don't know which lioness we have here. Again. That's suitably intimidating. Running away from the male, going back to join her pride. Oops, she's got herself stuck in the tree. There's a male right next to the vehicle. I'm lowering the spotlight a bit so I can see what these two are doing, because they're going to have a bit of a scrap next to us. She's about to get very cross with him if he doesn't let her past. And there they go. Okay. Our male is still standing, looking somewhat dazed and confused. A little bit like he's not quite sure exactly what he did wrong to deserve that growl that he got and the sudden exit of his female companion. And there he settles down. That wasn't really what I had planned, because behind me I can hear lots of growling, but I can also hear the cubs, and that means they're on their way towards us. So I'm sitting with my lights off behind me and just the spotlight in front of us. And so we find ourselves in the position once again, Dave. Hmm. Aren't we lucky? Oh, this is so amazing. I'm going to take, Dave, if I take my spotlight off, you see what happens. Sure. I'm just experimenting here. What I'd like to do, with Dave's permission, is I'd like to actually switch off the IR, just in case you don't believe us that there is absolutely no light. It's just going to be black, just to give you an idea of what I'm seeing with my eyes. Thank you. IR is gone. That's what the IR sees, and then what I'm seeing is pitch black. Amazing how the tapetum lucidum of these animals reflects the infrared light. That's fascinating. I suppose it makes sense. It's still just a wavelength of light, just like any other. Now what I'm going to do, because of the position we find ourselves in, I'm going to pop the spotlight back onto the male in front of us. And I'm just going to give a cursory examination of my surroundings, so I can see exactly where we are and where we should be. If the cubs start walking past us, or the lionesses decide to come in this direction, then we will immediately turn off the spotlight and just let them come past. But for now, they're quite a way behind me. They're a good couple of hundred meters behind the vehicle. Well now, if ever there was a pirate of the bush, I think perhaps our male lion is one. Really tough lives. Excuse me. And whilst we like to romanticize pirates, in a way, a male lion's life is kind of similar to the realities of what being a pirate was like. All of the pillaging and so on. Although slightly different. I'm not going to talk in pirate voices for the lions, though. Now, earlier on, one of the Birmingham boys walked right past the vehicle and then scent-marked the bush next to us. Cindy, you're wondering if we've ever had a lion scent-mark the vehicle. Not intentionally, Cindy, so they've never intentionally done it, but they have scent-marked in that they have walked up and sprayed the bush next to us. some of the residue has perhaps landed a little bit too close for comfort. The closest I can remember any of us coming to being scent marked by a lion was James. I happened to be in final control that day, and there was some deep concern from James's part that he was about to be scent marked by a large male lion, and I think he nearly was. I think the vehicle got some of the spray. Oh, such an exhausted boy. And hopefully this time you'll get to experience that lion roaring sound again. There is an incredible silence in the African bush at night. And of course it's filled with surface sounds. The crickets, the frogs are starting to all chirp. We've got olive toads, we've got bubbling cassinas, we've got rain frogs, all kinds of things starting their night chorus. And at the same time, there's this blanket of overlaying silence. Since our lion has decided to go to sleep, let us jump all the way back on board with James and have a look at what his spotted predator is doing.
Well, everybody, there's some real action here with the hyenas. We think we're close to the den, perhaps. There are a whole lot of animals there behind. But look, they're running towards just to the left-hand side of where we're sitting now. We'll try and get the infrared light on them now. There are four or five of them. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? That is so cool. Right in front of us now as well, Jean-Ré, maybe. Let's go infrared to them. Just right there. There we go. That's another one there. I'm just going to swing the car slightly, or you just keep following, Jean-Ré. Shall I move around slightly? Yeah, we're going to have to. Let's go there. Now, if you're wondering why there is such a clearing here, you might be thinking, gosh, Cheetah Plains has got larger than when I was last here. But you'd be wrong, everyone. This is the Mara Triangle, the spectacular piece of land up here in Kenya, southern Kenya, and part of the great Mara Serengeti ecosystem. This little chap's coming right past the front now. I think we're quite close to the den. There's obviously, you can see the pseudo penis stuck out there. There's been some kind of social interaction. Cannot be comfortable walking through the grass like that, but hey, there's a couple of animals that do it. Here comes a much bigger one. In fact, they're coming to investigate us. This is wonderful. Just make one out in the darkness here to the right, and another one coming in from there. Oh, there are lots. Good evening. Little one now. That's quite close, everyone. That's probably only about, oh, I don't know, 3 meters, 9 feet. I think they caught sight of one of Jean-Dre's dreadlocks. I'm a little bit nervous. This is wonderful stuff. There we can see the thermal imaging camera. Let me just lift that up for you, you'll see it a bit better. Hear one way in the distance across the river going whoop. Gosh, this is fun, isn't it? You go out with this kind of equipment. And all those little white dots are bits of this incredible diversity that occur here. All of those little white dots. I'm just going across to the left now to see. Ooh, I think that's an elephant. And there are three of them right in front of us. Let's go back to the IR. There they go. So we must be close to the den. I don't look, finding it in this light is going to be very difficult, but I think we must be very close by. Brilliant stuff. And that long loping gate, of course, they're designed precisely in the same way that a wildebeest is, so that they can run relatively slowly for a very long time. Hello, P. Hart. You have an interesting question about hyenas. For those of you who don't know, the spotted hyena has is almost hermaphroditic. They have female parts, and they have also they have what was known as a. Gosh, I'm bashing my head here. They have hello, everyone. They have what's known as false female, at least false male genitalia. And the clitoris is an enlarged pseudo penis. And P. Hart, you want to know basically what function that serves, and are they able to, or do they have to urinate out of it? The answer is yes. There we got a chicken bone. Is that a chicken bone there? It's obviously not a chicken bone, everybody. It's a joint of some kind of meat. That's very nice for that young hyena while he eats there. P. Hart, yes, they urinate out of it. The urethra is closed, basically, and they also give birth out of it. And it almost always, especially for a first birth, is extremely painful for a hyena and can, in fact, especially in a young hyena, can cause death. So it's quite an interesting discussion which we'll get into when perhaps we've got a bit more light. The evolutionary adaptation for why they should have that and why the social or the advantage of having such dangerous birth outweighed the disadvantage of the advantage of having that strange genitalia outweighed the disadvantage of the dangerous birth. Right, well, let's see what else Graham can find us. Graham, where are you pointing? Looks like some elephants up ahead. Right, before I drive over this very large mountain, which Graham has spotted with the thermal imaging camera, let's head across to Jamie and the Ninkapumas.
So while James attempts to navigate his mountain, our lion cubs have found a mountain of their own. The rest of the pride has continued on towards the west. I've let Taylor know so that she can start moving in that direction. But keep an eye on the Juma Dam camera. You never know if they might pop out around there, and it might give us a little bit of help. I can't follow them down into the Mulwati. That's definitely not going to work out too well for us. But look at this peaceful scene in front of you. Worn out by their rather long walk, they covered an amazing amount of ground from when we lost them to when we accidentally stumbled upon them again. Nine cubs are exhausted. Looking the pictures of innocence. Left behind whilst the rest of the females go out hunting, and one lioness remains to stand guard over one very, very precious brood. What an awesome picture. Obviously, I'm not going to go any closer to do a head count or to try and look for the rest of them. I can only see five of them, but I'm sure the rest are there as well. Just scattered on that termite mound. And isn't she just the picture of a guardian? Patiently protecting their very, very precious little group. While the other lionesses head off to go and find them some food. The recipe behind the success of lions as a species. Their social bonding and their social teamwork. The division of labor, the fact that a lioness suckles cubs that are not only her own, but also her sister's or her mother's or her daughter's, and then is invested in protecting them, whether they are hers or whether they are not. And she knows that her sisters and the rest of her pride will be out providing food. I've never ever got to see this before. In the middle of the night, in the darkness, with little lion cubs all flat out on a termite mound. And a lioness standing guard, or just lying guard, but you know what I mean. And whilst one lioness might not seem like much, she will absolutely be a force to be reckoned with. She is more than equal to almost any threat out here, from hyenas to leopards. The only thing she would not be able to save these cubs from is a strange male lion. Still being plagued. As our little lion cubs snooze away, daytime nap or nighttime nap time, let's jump on board with Taylor, who has got one of the creatures that we only see after it rains.
We've got millipedes, everybody, and not just one, but three millipedes. Can you see the other one over there? And then we've got another one further to the right. So many millipedes this evening, but let's go back to the one that was closest to us. And I'm watching it, and I'm seeing that this millipede has actually got mites on it. You see on the back legs, how those back legs, I don't know if you saw that on the left-hand side of your screen, that's the back end of it. But just watch carefully, because when it was still, it sort of looked like there were a few mites going around there, and it almost looked like this millipede was getting irritated by the activity of the mites, and I'm not sure what they would be feeding on. But millipedes are detrivites, so they eat organic matter. Like you can see, it looks like it's nibbling on that leaf. And they are quite lethal to a certain species of animals. They contain cyanide as a chemical defense, but fortunately for you and I, it won't do too much damage to us. It just is quite a foul-smelling substance that they produce. Now, if you were to eat a shongololo, the scientists reckon that you need to eat about 100 for it to affect you quite severely. But something like a civet, let me actually show you a photo of an African civet, everybody. Let me get my big mammals book out. Can you see the civet on the left? That is a civet, everybody, an African civet, and that creature loves to eat millipedes. Let's go back to our millipedes though and get zooming on in there. Look at them go around, and it was amazing. You normally see one or two crossing the road here and there, but to see three, a herd of millipedes, if you will, in an area, is quite hysterical to see. And these are large ones as well. I reckon this one that we're looking at now, the one closest to us, is so big it could probably wrap around my wrist. So I could have a nice little African bangle, I suppose. That one, how it's lifting its head up as it moves along. Now, they don't have a brain, they've got ganglia. Sort of like nerve endings. So all those little antennae that you see are sort of little feeling receptors. And that is directing and telling it where it should go. So even a millipede may even walk into a wall, but it will then turn around and realize that it's hit an object and have to go somewhere else. And it's quite interesting to see what this little one is getting up to this evening. So remember, everybody, you are watching this live. This is all happening right now. And oh, look at the mouse! Look at the mouse above it! Look at the little one! Where did it go? Where did it go? Oh my goodness, sorry, that, everybody, that happened so quickly. There was a tiny little mouse that jumped over the millipede on the left at the bottom of your screen over there. And I don't know where it's gone. I'm just having a quick scan. I think it's possibly gone into this termite mound where this millipede is disappearing into as well. That was incredible. Sorry that you didn't get to see that, but it happened so quickly, I'm afraid, that it was too quick. It happened in a split second. But maybe it comes out. So we'll just wait a little bit and to see if that little mouse does pop out again. That's amazing. So that millipede is going down into the going down into a termite mound. That was quite funny the way it slinked away like that. And now this one is coming closer. It's coming to investigate. I wonder if we can see those mites again. That was really quite interesting. And that's what I love about the bushes, is there's so much that you can learn out here. See it digging away over there. What are you looking for? Can you also hear all the sounds of the night? I'm going to sit very quietly for just a moment so you can hear all the insects and the frogs. Can you all hear that? It is amazing. Lots and lots of frogs. Now I'm hoping that we're having so much luck with all the different insects on the road, we're bound to bump into a frog. We have to bump into a frog. And that will just make my evening. Munching away, found a lovely leaf that it was enjoying. And these are the decomposers of the bush, and we really have to take a moment to stop and appreciate what they do for us. They get rid of all the dead leaves, all the dead grasses, and all the dead, well, the poop is definitely dead, but get rid of all the feces and dung that's left behind from all the various animals that we have here in the African bush. Have any of you ever heard of the word Shongololo? If you haven't, it's the South African word for a millipede, a Shongololo. Right, I think James has got a hippo for you.
There is a hippopotamus, everybody. Look at it there. It is going into a muddy gully through which we cannot follow it, I'm afraid. A little nervous of us, and so we're having to keep our distance. Isn't this amazing? This is what hippos do during the night, you see. They sometimes roll in the mud, they eat a lot of delicious red oat grass, and they clearly seem either this one is offensive and hasn't got any friends, or they like to be alone. They are very blubberous, though. See them waddling there, a huge amount of fat. I'm going to try and go a little bit closer to the edge of the gully there. John, I can't see it now. There it goes, disappearing to the night. I'm afraid I think that's going to be the end of our hippo sighting. We'll see what else Mr. Wallington and his thermal imaging camera can find us. We went back to a road, and Graham then found some shining things, and those shining things turned out to be dung. Find the road again. Of course, this is the problem with being completely unfamiliar with an area. Now, the fact that you've got a Shongololo out of Juma tells me that the rain must have been wonderful, and I'm sure it comes as a great relief to all, especially David, who predicted it correctly, and he got it right for Mara as well. We had a storm on exactly the same time that you did over there in Juma, which is fantastic. Right, we're going back towards the road, and then we're going to head back towards those lions and see what they're up to. We couldn't find the rest of the pride. Right, and while we're going to find our lions, let's head back to the slightly more familiar ones of Juma with Jamie.
Familiar lions indeed, and my mistake, I thought the rest of the pride had gone wandering off, but they came back again and all popped out and lay down with the rest of them. So the females are, there's at least four of them here that I can see. I didn't even realize the whole time I was talking about the adult female being on her own, that there's actually very clearly a lioness head on the right-hand side of the termite mound. But in my defense, this whole deal takes a little bit of getting used to. It's not a lioness head at all. It's a blade of grass and a shadow and a cub. It is. I thought there was an adult lioness there. Oh, there you go. I told you. It takes some getting used to. It is the very surreal experience. But for now, our lion's resting up quite comfortably. And hello to Nicole in Toronto. You wanted to know if there is usually a lioness sitting with the cubs whilst the rest of them go hunting. And the answer, this is really weird because now I'm taking my eyes off the monitor and I can't see anything. There sometimes is, but a lot of the time the lionesses will leave their cubs in a nice safe place. This isn't a safe place, it's not nice and tucked away in a drainage line where they're a bit more protected, or a river system that cuts through the ground and creates nice rocky or sandy areas. And go back to looking at the lions so that I can see what's going on, because it's a very surreal feeling. And I know that they're not moving, but at the same time, I can't even watch out of my peripheral vision to see if they get up and move or do something. So Victoria, you might occasionally see it, but they do, even at this age, still leave the cubs behind every now and again. The lions that we saw do that relatively frequently were the Styx lions, but then they only had 3 lionesses with 8 cubs at that point. I think Ormas do have 5, and I don't think all of them are here. I think that I've seen at least 3. But the other 2 might have gone off hunting. I thought I said 4, but that was when I thought a blade of grass was a lion. So there's at least 3 here. The other 2 might have gone off, and with the Birmingham boys as well, in the direction of Twin Dams and possibly even Inga's house. I'm listening carefully to the sounds of the night to see whether or not they roar for us again, because the best part of that whole experience was the cubs. It was amazing. It's incredible to see that instinct kick in, and they all start yowling, making a terrible racket, and it doesn't sound anything like a lion roar, but it is adorable to witness as they stand there looking all big and proud of themselves with their chests puffed out going row. Oh, I better not make too many noises. No strange noises in the night. It is interesting. This whole experience is going to give us a brand new insight into the way in which all of the animals operate at night, not just the Nkuma pride, although we've been very fortunate to kick off with this, but leopards, elephants, even the other mysterious nocturnal creatures that we have a chance of seeing, like, dare I say it, an aardvark, but also just civets, white-tailed mongoose, honey badgers. The possibilities are endless. And during the summertime, it's usually our worst time for seeing nocturnal creatures, because when the days are hot, the nocturnal creatures usually only come out much later. But now we've got plenty of time to see whether or not they pop out. And we have the added advantage of not having to have our vehicle lights on, and therefore we're not attracting any insects. No moths or anything like that for now. Although that will form part of the exciting safari. I wasn't planning on finding these lions again at all, at least the cubs. I was looking for the male lion, and then if I hadn't found him, I was going to go and do a full boundary patrol of Juma to see what nocturnal creatures were scurrying about there. This has definitely changed my plan for the evening, and just goes to show the futility of even having a plan most of the time. When you're doing safaris, plans never ever go as they should. There was such a deep sigh from that lioness. And anything could happen. While we're sitting here, these lionesses might be patiently babysitting, but at the same time, if an creature came wandering through, a herd of impala perhaps, or a kudu or anything like that, then they would immediately take the opportunity to try and hunt it. And we always live on the edge of our seats in anticipation in this kind of situation. And that's one of the big reasons why a lot of the time the diurnal animals, the antelope, don't necessarily move around too much. They can see, Not brilliantly, but they can see at night. But I think they'd prefer to rather stand still and take their chances than risk stumbling into a lion resting somewhere peacefully in the bushes. Can't believe how deeply these cubs are asleep. I suppose it makes sense. They've got lots and lots of growing to do. And they need plenty of rest. And we all know that lions can be champion sleepers. So it only makes sense that that's another instinct that they have inherited. But I do imagine that there are some people with very small babies and children that would wish that their little ones could sleep quite so peacefully. Bear with me one moment. Taylor's trying to call me on the Game Drive comms. I just want to give her a little bit of info as to where the lions went. Standing by. Copy, they might not have crossed just yet. They went west from Vulture's Nest, quite close to where the Harrier Hawk Nest is, just south of that. Fast asleep. Every now and again, the lionesses do glance up at us, and it's weird to think that they can see us perfectly, perfectly clearly. They know exactly what we are and that we're here, and I can't see them at all. I've had a few moments, rare moments, but a few moments where I've had to go walking through the bush at night, a combination of stuck vehicles and various other things, various other reasons. Or to check power boxes and so on. We've all had to do it in our time. And I have to tell you, it's quite a bone-chilling experience walking about out here without any... Obviously, you don't do it without a torch. You do go wandering through. One particularly memorable experience was with a car that was stuck. And I had to go out searching for bits of wood that I could pack under the wheels to try and get it out of the mud that it was stuck in. Because the four-wheel drive didn't engage. I'm jacking it up and sticking wood under the wheels. Let's go across to James, who's got a predator right next to the car.
Just behind the snorkel, a little hyena is coming across. Hello. Young hyena. What do you think it's smelling, Jean-André? Hello. Yes, good day. I know you can't see this, everyone, but the hyena is now staring me in the eyes. And hyenas, of course, become quite bold at the night time. And now I'm doing what young hyenas everywhere do best, and that is pull off the oil cap on the wheel. Please do not pull off the oil cap on the wheel. There's another one here now, Chandra. Two hyena. I can hear lions pulling away in the distance. Oops. Lifting the earpiece out. There they are. It's so cool. I don't think we can see them. But we can. Probably there's another one just about to climb in the window here on the right. Not sure if you can see it. There we are. Beautiful shot of the roof rack there. Unfortunately, Jean-André did try and take it to that with an angle grinder, but the owner of the vehicle took offence, and so he was unable to cut it off. These hyenas can't believe what they've found. They've never seen a vehicle driving around here at this time of the day. I'm afraid I have no idea. Hello, Diane. You're wondering about whether or not the hyenas are here or as accustomed to vehicles as they are in the Sabi sand. Yes, I think they probably are. You know, they get viewed a huge number of tourists that come through here. They're just not allowed to drive around at night. I think one just could easily have tried to climb in the window there. There we are. Maybe my audio is a little bit dodgy. How's it now, Rebecca? I think it's because I put a jersey on. There we go. So yes, they're absolutely as habituated, but they don't get viewed at night ever because the general populace, the average punter, as it were, is not privileged like you and I to be driving around here at night. This is wonderful. I have no idea where they are. Chandra, which side of the vehicle are they? Left side. Okay. There we are. And of course, if I was a pirate, I would say, just off the port, stern. Eating something that's found. Delicious. I should, of course, have brought a parrot to sit on my shoulder during the day, but they get hungry and they make a noise. They're just getting to the edge of the infrared range now. And there, I believe we shall carry on and see if we can find the lions again. Very nice. Any more hyenas right in front of us? I can smell them, you know. Very strange smell. It's a very kind of sickly sweetish smell. It smells exactly like the den on Aubrey's Road. All right, let's head across to Taylor while that hyena disappears into the darkness. Find out what she has to show you, and we'll head towards the lions.
I actually cannot believe what I'm looking at, everybody. Can you even picture, or can you even spot what we are looking at the screen? This is a tailless whip scorpion. Now, it is pretty impressive the way that it is camouflaged like that. And these whip scorpions are in fact carnivores, so they'll catch, or insectivores, I suppose you could say. They are looking for little insects to see. Now, I've been seeing lots of cockroaches and all other critters coming through here, so I'm wondering if we're going to see a kill tonight. And if you zoom in there, Eggsy, let's see if we can zoom in a little bit more. I'm particularly wanting to look at their pincers. And that's as far as we can go, everybody. But they've got very, very powerful pincers, which they'll use to capture their prey. Now look at this ant. See how this ant is sort of going around the legs. And every now and then this whip scorpion shakes its leg and sort of shakes the ant off as well. Now I'm not sure if there's a relationship between the ant and the scorpion. I know ants are very good at cleaning. We often see birds and ants having a nice relationship. So I wonder if there's something similar where they could come through and maybe eat off the dead sort of exoskeleton bits of people, or maybe even mites they'll feed on. I'm not 100% sure, but the ants were very intrigued by this whip scorpion. Quite amazing. I haven't seen one in a long time. I think the last time I saw one was possibly in Zambia. That was ages ago. Lots of ants around that are also coming out. There we go. See how well camouflaged it is over there. Who has never seen a whip scorpion before? I'd like to hear from you and see if you've... I'm lost on my words tonight. I'm actually just enjoying this so much as to how productive this evening game drive has been. And I'd love to hear from you if you've never seen a whip scorpion before. And my question to all of the viewers is, would you pick up a whip scorpion, or would you be like me and be a bit of a sissy and just prefer to leave it on the floor and shine a spotlight on it and get the camera to zoom in? Because I don't know if I'm brave enough and if I'd pick up one of these. I don't think they can harm you. Maybe the pincers could hurt, but they have no venom, unlike the normal scorpions that we see. Though in this area as well, the scorpions that do come out every now and then aren't life-threatening. May give you a bit of a headache, make you feel a little bit nauseous, but I don't think any of them will kill you. Ah, and I was just reading very quickly about this whip scorpion, and apparently one of their favorite foods is actually cockroaches. So the cockroach, let's see, have we still got the cockroach? Where is it? There it is. Hopefully this whip scorpion will figure out that this cockroach is around. Right, well, James, I believe, has got one of the feathery creatures of the night.
Now, there is a nightjar, everyone. What kind of nightjar it is, I am unable to tell you. It is quite possibly a square-tailed nightjar. I'm looking at the picture now. They do occur here, slender-tailed. They do not occur here, so it's not... they might. It's almost impossible to tell everyone, simply because, well, they're in IR, and unless they call, unless you get a really good color view of them, it becomes totally impossible to tell what they are. But he's quite sweet, isn't he? He looks like a juvenile. I just say that because he's a bit scruffy looking, and we nearly ran him over. He was sitting completely silently on the road there. Now, the big thing about a nightjar like this, and I don't know if we definitely won't be able to see it tonight, because if he flies up, you see how quickly that happened. That's very cool. Let me tell you how that happens. They've got extremely broad wings, which means that one or two flaps throws them into the air very quickly. Is he back? I think he's back. There he is. So one or two flaps of those very broad wings tosses him up into the air very fast. He's not very good at sort of gliding, but he can gain speed very quickly. Now, how he does that, or the reason he does that, is because he picks up insects often in the air. I think he just picked one off the ground there. And if you look at most nightjars, their eyes are placed quite far to the top of the head, and they look right above them. And being able to flap straight up like that means that they can grab insects that are flying over the top of their heads. So they hide down, hunker down in some clearing like that, or in a little gully like the one he was in, and they flap once or twice and they shoot up into the air and grab the insect that's just flown over the top of them. Which I think is a rather clever strategy. And I don't know of any other bird that's able to do that, to be honest. Right, on we go. Now, let's quickly just show up there, Jean-Drew, if you wouldn't mind. There we are. Look at those lights there everywhere. That is where we are staying. It's quite possibly the finest establishment in the world. It's known as Angama Mara. And that is where our delicious packed dinners will be waiting for us when we return home. Yum, yum. Sorry, Jeffrey, I missed your question. We'll carry on driving while I answer it. Oh, Jeffrey, you want to know what birds we find here that we don't find at Juma? Jeffrey, there are quite a few. Certainly, I'm not experienced enough to list them all offhand, but obvious examples would include the Rupel's vulture, the purple grenadier, which is a very pleasant little sort of seed eater, the cordon bleu, which basically looks, well, there are various kinds of cordon bleu. They look like wax bills. And what else do we get here? Offhand. Many of the same sort of things, but in different numbers. So like an auger buzzard is quite a common bird here. And many more vultures that we get in the Sabi Sand, and that's because so much dies of natural causes. great spotted eagle, which is quite interesting, and something called an imperial eagle, which I haven't yet seen, and I'd quite like to. Right, Taylor, I believe, has found yet another little nocturnal creature. Let's go and find out what it is.
We have seen this beetle before, just a few moments ago. These are two-spot beetles, and we have got them mating. And I can't see what the one at the bottom is eating, but it looks like it is eating something. I don't know if you can all see that. What on earth are you doing? It's quite difficult to see, and unfortunately this is as far as we can zoom in, everybody, but this is quite fascinating. Now, I have got absolutely no idea about mating two-spot beetles. This is the first time I've ever seen anything like this before. And this is what happens after the rain, everybody, and why it's my favorite time of the year is because everybody is so excited of all the new things that are to come after the rain. The ground is nice and soft, it's easy for the insects to burrow and to lay their eggs, and I'm also being plagued by cockroaches and all sorts of flying insects at the moment, so I'm trying to be very brave here and not jump and swat at things. Well, I can say that Eggsy's in the same boat as I am this evening. But isn't this fantastic? And while these two copulate, I want to point out the yellow spots that you can see on their backs. Can you see them? And that's why they're called two-spot beetles, is because of those spots on their back. And notice how they are bright yellow. Now, normally with insects, you have something called aposematic coloration, which will have bright colors, usually yellows and oranges and reds, and typically on quite a dark background like you're seeing here. And they're normally warning colors to say, keep away from me, I am poisonous. Now, I'm not sure if the two-spot beetles have got any toxin that is unique to them. That is also something I'm going to have to do a little bit of research on. And I'm so excited that I'm able to see all these new things this evening, because all it's going to do is it's going to broaden my knowledge, as well as all of you at home who are watching this. Amazing. Thank you so much, beetles. I think we're going to let them carry on copulating, and I'm going to carry on driving and seeing what else we can find. Let's see what else is on this road up ahead in front of us. We're having so much luck on a Twin Dams Road this evening. So everybody, if you have just tuned into our live night safari. Oh, wait, have we got here? Oh, we've got more! You can't see them, but I've got another pair of mating twin spot beetles. They're everywhere. So sorry, if you've just joined in to the show, we're actually live on a night safari as we speak. And I'm finding plenty of mating twin spot beetles this evening. It's quite exciting, everybody. And what else have we got? I see some eye shine over here, but I think that's a bit too small. Probably the eyes of a very tiny spider. It might be a bit too difficult to see. So we are in Africa at the moment, and we are on Duma Private Game Reserve, which is situated in the Sabi Sands. I have to show you another pair of mating twin spot beetles in case you think that I'm making this up. They are around every corner we turn. They're everywhere. Very exciting. I don't know if Safari Live has ever managed to record mating two-spot beetles. I think they call them twin-spot beetles as well, because I keep getting muddled up. And you see, I don't know what's going on, but it's quite interesting. Every pair that we've seen so far, the female, which I presume is the bigger one and at the bottom, is eating something. Well, I don't know what she is doing there. I'm very uncertain on a certain insect behavior. But it's very interesting, and I'm going to have to make a note of this and see if I can find any information about it, or possibly one of the other guides maybe knows something about this. Maybe James or Jamie have seen something along these lines over the years. It'll make for a very interesting dinner conversation, because that's what we like to speak about. Oh, I don't want to squash this lovely honeymoon couple, and we will try and avoid squashing all the honeymoon couples this evening. See who else we've got. Some interesting smells in the bush tonight as well. Something smells like it's dying. Doesn't smell very nice at all. Oh, what else have we got around here? I'm sort of looking on the ground. I've stopped looking for all the big creatures, everybody, and I'm having so much fun finding all these insects. No, not, nothing. I get excited when I see a dark patch on the ground. I can see a lot of eye shine from a lot of things, but very small things, and I'm not sure what they are. Do you think you can get that some of that eye shine that we're seeing over there? I don't know what it's going to be. I don't know if you at home can actually see that eye shine on the dung. No, you can't. It's quite difficult. Can you go to the right, Eggsy? There's something sitting in there, but unfortunately I cannot show you what it is. Possibly a tiny little spider. But let's cross over and see how Jamie's doing.
Well, Taylor is focusing, it's late, focusing on the smaller things. We have got some very small lion cubs to show you, who have barely moved since we arrived here. Fast asleep on their termite mound bed, positively snuggled in, although I have to say the one on the bottom really doesn't look terribly comfortable. That really looks horribly uncomfortable. All twisted round and with gravity acting against them. It doesn't seem too bothered though, does it? The lionesses are also fast asleep. I've just been sitting here thinking how incredibly privileged we are that we're able to sit in the dark and watch an entire pride of lions slumber away peacefully. Pitch black, just listening to the sounds of the bush and watching the stars slowly move overhead. Obviously the stars are not moving, we are, but that's the way it looks. Scorpius is slowly making its way back towards the horizon, and Orion will be coming up in just a few short hours. And we can't show you the stars, unfortunately. Dave and I tried it earlier, it doesn't really work at all. You get sort of maybe a couple of blobs, but that's about that. But let me just tell you that if you want to come and see amazing stars, there is no better place in the world to come into the middle of the African bush, turn off all your lights, and just look up at the constellations. The lions don't seem to be terribly bothered by them. I suppose it's a bit passé for them. It's amazing how heightened my senses have become. Obviously, I'm watching on my monitor to see what the lions are doing. But at the same time, I can tell you that I can hear them breathing. If I listen really closely, I can hear them breathing and sighing every now and again. And I can smell them from where I'm sitting. Admittedly, I am downwind of them, and they have just eaten a carcass. So they don't smell particularly pleasant. But I can smell them and I can hear them, which is something that at this distance during the day, I probably wouldn't be able to do. Our other senses become vibrantly heightened when we sit in the dark like this. Cub pile. I suppose they've earned their rest. The Nkuhumas have taken down multiple prey items. Now, Jason, you were wondering if that is an active termite mound and if perhaps it's giving off heat for them. That's actually really not a bad suggestion. It isn't, as far as I can tell, that active. It might be. As you know, most of the termite mounds that we see, well, most of what we see is just a tiny little portion of what's really going on beneath the surface of the soil. Just the tip of the iceberg, so to speak. So yes, it could be an active one. I haven't seen any signs of activity, but that doesn't mean that it isn't active. And there's a possibility it's keeping them warm, although it's not too cool tonight, and they will be warm from their walk. But not a bad suggestion, and I wouldn't be surprised if that's something they do in winter. Well, Taylor's done it again. More insect life out and about. Let's go and see what she's found this time.
I have got a scorpion for you. I'm just going to drive in circles around this road. Now, I'm just trying to quickly read the name of this. Now, this scorpion doesn't have a common name, and the Latin name for it is Ostepacanthus asper, And those of you who watched James about a week ago in the tent here at Juma Private Game Reserve, you'll remember that I found one for him on a tree, a gwari tree. So I just remember making a note about this scorpion, and I couldn't remember the Latin name, but isn't it beautiful? So you can see it's got a lovely big pincers. Can you see all the big pincers that it got? So this, this means that the scorpion is actively hunting. So it's using their pincers in order to catch something. You see, it's got a very small tail, so the tail is not its main weapon. So I reckon if it stung you, it's probably going to hurt, and you're going to have a headache for an hour or maybe a few hours. But you don't need to go to hospital with this one. But I don't like to pick up scorpions. Either James was very brave the other day, and even though it's taken him a while, I think, to pick up a scorpion, and he's been doing this for years and years. So this is quite amazing to see. And also out on the prowl, and you won't believe, I actually even had a solifuge quite close to the spider. I mean, quite close to the scorpion. But fortunately, I lost it. But I will try and find it again for you. Let me very quickly scan. I just want to see, because it wasn't too far away from the vehicle. Please excuse me for 2 seconds. Nope, it's not yet. I'll have to do some hunting for the solifuge. But it's turning out to be quite an active area for all those insects. I wonder what else we can find. We are crossing a lot of these amazing creatures off the list just in our first night. And we just saw a whip scorpion, everybody, which is a very special thing to see out in the bush. And Liz said that she would be willing to pick up a whip scorpion, even because they are harmless to humans. Now, I said earlier that they were harmless. However, Liz, you are a lot braver than I am, even though they are quite pleasant little creatures. And I actually went and took a photo of it when we left, because it was tiny. I don't know if I could pick it up. I was thinking about it, but then I just decided that that's not for me. I'll leave them on the ground and view them like this. So as the scorpion is moving around, it's got little hairs on its legs and around its body that are sort of sensory nerve hairs. So that's what it's also going to be using to try and pick up the vibrations of any little insects that could possibly be around and that it can go and look for. I don't think these scorpions burrow. I think they do like to live in the bark of trees, if I'm not mistaken. And as the months warm up, we should start to see the burrowing scorpions, which are much larger. They're almost double the size of the scorpion. This scorpion is probably, I'm trying to give you, probably the length of your index finger. Not much bigger than that. Probably only about 5 or 6 centimeters. This little chap is quite active this evening. And off he goes into the darkness in search of his next meal. Wouldn't it be amazing if we saw a scorpion hunt? I don't think I've ever seen a scorpion hunt before. Can you all hear the lovely birds and frogs and the scops owl that's calling in the distance? I'll keep quiet so you can see if you can hear it. Hopefully you've all cranked the volume up so you could hear what I'm hearing. It's so beautiful and peaceful this evening. Not a breath of wind, everybody. I've still got just a shirt on. I haven't even had to put my jersey on just yet. Now, something that I'm missing in my box of tricks as a guide, and it's something that I need to get my hands of, and James Bear has just asked if I've got a ultraviolet light. James, I unfortunately don't, but as soon as I go on holiday, I think the first thing I'm going to do is buy an ultraviolet light, because wouldn't that be amazing if we could see what the scorpion looks like? So if you don't know what happens when you shine an ultraviolet light on a scorpion, they sort of shine bright blue. It's quite spectacular, and that's something that I'm going to definitely get. And hopefully we do more of these night segments and we can find little critters like this, and then I'll be able to show you. And that's actually a really good way to try and find scorpions, is if you are turning up rocks. So I would hope that you wouldn't be walking around at night on a big five area. Perhaps in an area where you knew there were no dangerous animals, it's okay. And you can use it, you turn over rocks and you just shine that light and you should get that lovely blue glow from the scorpion. And lovely how the scorpion is just going over obstacles, that small branch on the ground. And only if it knew that about 10 meters away for it was some two-spot beetles. And I wonder if they would go for something that big, because the two-spot beetles are probably half the size of that scorpion. Right, I think we're going to let this little scorpion carry on with his nightly adventures. And let's go see how the Nkuhumas are doing with Jamie.
It's all go, go, go here at the Lion Pride. Or not quite. A lazy evening for them. Not up to terribly much. I saw an ear twitch and a head lift at one point. That little cub's making itself slightly more comfortable. But for the most part, our lion's showing no inclination to get up and get moving just yet. I have a suspicion, after I said that those male lions had moved off, I actually have a suspicion, because I keep hearing gentle sighs from further into the bush, that they haven't actually gone as far as I thought they had. I think they might still be close by, perhaps hoping for another opportunity to prove their worth to the young female and to Amber Eyes, the only two females without cubs and therefore the only potential mating options. And they've certainly worked very hard at attempting to convince those lionesses, and so far, in the last week or so, haven't been terribly successful. The lionesses have met their approaches with a no small measure of aggression every now and again. If they get too close, they get the odd smack across the nose. And I have to tell you, after our incredible experience earlier in the darkness, my favourite moment of today, after that one, because that was incredible, was when the lioness walked up to the male lion and just bopped him on the nose, ever so gently. Claws not extended, claws still retracted. Oh, look, it's dreaming. I think it is. It's twitching, maybe just getting comfortable. I haven't seen that before in the bush, that gentle bop on the nose. And it'll go down as one of my favourite Nkuhuma Birmingham interactions with each other. I like the question, though, about the termite mound giving off heat. I think there is an aspect to that as well. And that's something that we have to look forward to after the rain, is the explosion of flying ants or winged termites that will be coming out at some point, hopefully soon, and we'll get a chance to see all of the animals that are gathering to feed on them. I've even seen hyenas licking termite mounds and licking up termites when you get those populations explosions. They're very, very important sources of protein for a lot of the animals out here. I haven't seen lions feeding off them, but you never know. Lions can be very strange creatures. I think after a little bit more time spent with these lions, we're probably going to move on and do a boundary patrol. I'm dying to do a boundary patrol. I want to go and see what's coming and going, coming into Juma, leaving Juma. And there's always the possibility of the queen making a surprise appearance. Karula spends a lot of her time walking along the southern boundary. I think that will be our plan. Ooh, a moth. Photobombed by a moth. We also go and find the insects that have been popping out after the rain. Earlier on, Dave was sitting in the dark behind me and I just heard him go, "Ah, a bat just flew right past my face." And there's all kinds of things to spot. Dave, what do you think the chances are of filming a bat flying in infrared?
We can try.
You can try. Alrighty, well, since our lions have decided that they're going to remain very much asleep, let's head across all the way to the Mara and find out if James's have different plans.
We've come back to the lions, everybody. They are astonishingly excited by their lives. You can see this female stuck her head up, her black backed ears were glistening in the blackness of this night. And the lion, well, I think he's alive. Yes, he is, he's breathing. Well done. Good for you, old fellow. There was a little bit of calling. Sorry, my audio is a bit muffled because my head is twisted looking. Is that better, Rebecca? Rebecca's on a 9-second delay, so she can only tell me 9 seconds after I tell her. Right, good, that sounds a bit better. So that's what the lions are doing, nothing. We're going to wait and see if they call again, and then I think we're going to do another little sojourn around the place to see if there aren't some others. We did hear some calling further towards where that crossing was earlier, so it might be worth just popping down there, or certainly some of the way there, and see what happens. She's listening to something now. Let us too listen. Chandra. Chandra. What can you hear? I can't hear anything either. But she can. She's got good ears. Now, for those of you who have just joined us, we've just met these lions. Which is a great joy, of course, to meet new lions. It's always nice to make a new friend. They are part of what we call the Kichwa Tembo Pride, which is made up of 6 lionesses, used to be made up of 7 cubs. 5 of them at least are dead. And Red, you wanted to know what the name of the pride was. Well, that's it, Kichwa Tembo. I'll tell you a bit about that shortly. There's a rumor that there are 2 still alive, but everybody else seems to think that they're dead. I've heard one rumor. Now that's because these 3 males, could be 4, have come into the area as new males. They've chased out the old chap called Scarface, as far as I know. And they are the Marsh Coalition males. So they have a really kind of deep attachment to that most famous of lion prides, the Marsh Pride from the Big Cat Diaries. So that's what's going on here. She's spotted something here. Now Desiree has asked a very clever question, and I don't really know the answer, but I think I'm going to give you the answer that you'd quite like to hear. You want to know if, well, we all know that obviously when there's a coalition takeover like this, the new males come in and they kill the cubs, and that's obviously very unpleasant for us to watch. But you want to know if a lioness is pregnant when the coalition takeover takes place, will the new males still kill the cubs? And I think the answer is probably not, no. I think they would assume, presumably, if it didn't happen sort of a day after they arrived, I think that they would assume that those lioned cubs were theirs, especially if the females, or some of the females in the pride had come into an estrus or estrus and they had mated. Not even necessarily with the lioness who was pregnant. I think they'd be okay then. So she's heard something, and she killed a little wildebeest today. We managed to watch that astoundingly, and we just popped out of the camp and to go and sort of scout the landscape before we came live, and there she killed a little wildebeest, which was quite astounding to see. Now she can hear something else. So let's see what happens. Maybe a warthog is out for a midnight stroll. The thermal camera is pointing, I think, towards where she was looking. It might just be that she can hear lions calling way in the distance. Now, Red, Kichwa Tembo means, and I've got Simon here with me, so he can tell me if I'm talking rubbish. Kichwa, I think, is a head, correct?
Head of an elephant.
Is the head of an elephant. So Kichwa Tembo, head of the elephant. And there's a camp not too far from here called Kichwa Tembo. And I think it's after that camp that this lion pride is named. And because of that, it's also sometimes known as the Olulolo pride, and that is the gate and the escarpment on which our camp sits. I'm not sure, does Olulolo have a name, have a meaning? What does it mean? Okay, it means meandering. Okay, that's quite interesting. So like a winding river, Olulolo means winding, or the escarpment. So that's what this pride has been known as as well. But we'll call them the Kichwa pride. That seems to be the general consensus in the area. One might also call them the recumbent pride, the sleepy pride at the moment, same as the Nkuhumas. You can see lions in East Africa and South Africa are the same. Okay, she's going to call. Well, that was very impressive indeed. She's looking towards where the other males are. That was very cool. Now, some people will tell you that they can hear the difference between a male and a female lion's call. I consider myself to be a person of very sensitive ears, and I can hear the difference between those two lions, but to be able to tell which one was male and which one was female, well, I think it'd be quite difficult. She's, I suppose, got a slightly higher pitched voice, but it's hardly a sort of ringing soprano to his deep voice. And that's them marking territory. They're just telling all the other lions in the area, this is our spot. I think she's also trying to make contact with the rest of the pride. Maybe they're calling. We did a long loop, everybody, round about where they were found this morning. Nothing so far. Let's just listen carefully. We're going to be quiet for 20 seconds and see if we can't hear something. Hear some way in the distance. That sounds like over the marsh, perhaps to the north. Well, that was great. They may well call again. The two other males are lying so flat on the road, their bottoms facing out, so they're really not looking in there at their best, and they're not doing anything. So let's just sit here for a bit longer, and then we'll go for another sort of scanning of the area with the infrared torch. Not infrared, the, what's it called again? Thermal imaging torch. Just remember, this is coming to you from two amazing locations. Obviously, the iconic Kruger National Park in the south and the Mara Triangle up here in Kenya. Now, Taylor has seemed to have had a magnificent evening, especially after the new rains, finding lots and lots of little creepy, crawly things. Let's go and take a look at the latest edition.
I have no idea what type of ground beetle this one is. I've never seen it before. Look at its remarkable pattern, though, on its shield. That's really, really beautiful with all those little spots. I'd love it if I could get a little bit closer to it, just to be able to see if it is spots or if it's maybe little grooves on the back of its carapace. But I'm a little bit unsure. And that's what I am just absolutely loving tonight, is I've never seen a ground beetle that looks anything like this before. I mean, the most common ones that we see are the two-spot beetles that we've been looking at. So these are also known as tyrant beetles, the ground beetles. So I'm going to be doing so much research this evening, I'm not going to be able to go to bed. I'll have to look up all these different things. Now, there's quite a few different critters crawling around here. I'm going to see if I can try and spot another one for you. I saw some more over here. Let me just have a quick scan. No, where did you go? There's one on the tree, looks like a cockroach. Also, I don't know what type of cockroach we've got there, but it looks like it could be one going underneath the bark of this dead marula tree that the elephants have kindly pushed over for us. And I think it was last night that I was looking, or possibly the night before, that I was looking under the bark of a marula trying to find something like a scorpion or something along those lines of these beetles. And that's where these insects are living during the day. Should we have a look at our little tyrant beetle just to keep out of the harsh sun? And most of these beetles that we're seeing as well are nocturnal, which makes sense as to why we are seeing them now and why I never see them during the day. We've also got some bats and things flying overhead. Did you see the fish moth to the top left of your screen? Can you maybe zoom in a little bit? It was moving around. No, now it's gone under all those goodies, but I just saw it, just caught my eye just as this beetle was moving out of sight. A little fish moth was around too. There's lots of little creepy crawlies around here. While we're just sitting, I'm just again just quickly having a little scan just to see if I can possibly spot something else for us. And I've had to put a jacket on now because it has got a bit chilly just from moving around. Now I can't see our beetle anymore. Our beetle is gone. Let me scan around here. Everybody, please excuse if you're not seeing anything. You can see me moving the spotlight very slowly just to see if we can spot another insect. I've got another millipede for you, and I've got a little millipede. Ooh, can you see it over there? The little millipede, much smaller than the ones we saw earlier. This one's not moving too much. I wonder if it isn't because it has got a little bit chilly this evening, and Thai Town wants to know how much does the temperature drop in the evenings. Tonight it hasn't dropped too much. If I'm not mistaken, I think we were 83 degrees Fahrenheit this afternoon, and it's probably around between 70 and 75 now, maybe even a little bit less than that, but it's not cold at all. It's just a little bit chilly as we're driving along, and that's probably the coldest thing about a safari. And when you do come on safari in winter, it's not that the temperature is low, it's that early in the mornings and late in the evenings, once the sun drops behind the horizon, that chill factor that's coming off of the air really freezes you. I wasn't too far off. Thank you, Rebecca, in final control. Rebecca says the temperature now is currently 69 degrees Fahrenheit. So I was just off by one. Not too shabby. I'm getting good at this guessing the weather or guessing the temperature. Oh, there we go. This little one has started moving now. Also, just munching away on a leaf. That seems to be their favorite food at the moment, are these decomposing leaves. Right, let's leave this millipede. Let's see what else we can find in the bush this evening. We're going to very carefully look down at the road so we don't squash any of our honeymoon beetles that we've been seeing around every corner. There's lots of them around. Now, that scorpion that we saw probably about 10 minutes ago, I was redoing a little bit of reading because I like to read in between and obviously broaden my knowledge whenever I can. And if only that scorpion could come around to all these little millipedes. Apparently that specific species. Oh wow, look at this. We've had an accident. Sorry. Apparently that species, the Ostepacanthus asper scorpion, likes to feed on millipedes. Look here, we've got a bit of a crime scene, everybody. Can you see that? I think, unfortunately, these beetles were trodden on, or actually, maybe not even. Look at all the ants coming through to devour what's left of these beetles. They actually look intact. Possibly it was an ambush by all these little ants. We will never know. I am not a part of the CSI, unfortunately, and I won't be able to do a very good autopsy as to what's going on over here. However, I do know that the ants are going to have a feast tonight. Buffet a la the two-spot beetle. Oh, you can still see that one kicking. Help me! Help me! And I have to show you the onlooker. If you go a little bit up, look at the bug. That's the onlooker laughing away, going ha 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 ha. Only the strongest shall survive. Now, good evening, Tucker. Tucker, who is 4 years old. Thank you for watching the show, Tucker. Well, so Tucker really loves all bugs and insects, and he wants to know, do we get any worms? Yes, we do. We get lots of different types of worms. One of my favorite worms are earthworms, though. And that's quite amazing. Tucker, maybe what you should try and do is ask your mom if you can get an earthworm farm. Quite amazing. And maybe you could get some of the juice that they produce. And that was also rhyming unintentionally. And then your mom can use it for her garden as well. Worm juice, as they call it. You can even see the importance of things, something small like ants, which I know plague a lot of kitchens, and they are not the favorite of most chefs, but they are the cleanup crew as well. By tomorrow morning, there'll probably just be a little bit of the exoskeleton that's left, and that's really it. Everything else would have been devoured by these ants. I'm glad I'm not these beetles, though. Here we go. We always see lions and leopards feeding on animals. I don't know when I last watched an ant devour another insect. Well, that was quite nice. Let's carry on. Whoa. I'm just going to make sure that I don't kill anybody as I drive on here. But while I find you something else to look at, James has got the lions again.
They've lifted their heads, everybody. This lion has lifted his head. He's yawned. He's looked into the night, and perhaps he's about to go stalking off into the darkness. Or maybe he'll go to sleep. Yes, his eyes are becoming heavy. Oh, shame. Oh. There you go. Ooh. Come on, give us a call. This is wonderful. Are calling as well. You never get tired of that, everyone. And this female, I think, is in search of the rest of her pride. And they're so full, just in case you're wondering why they're not hunting, why they're not doing anything more effective than snooze, Well, it's for exactly the same reason, of course, that the Nkuhuma pride isn't doing a great deal of hunting at the moment. It's simply because they've eaten so much over the last little while, especially in this area. I've had all of those wildebeests to devour, and so that's what they've been doing, and that's why they're hungry, and that's why they're not hungry. So I think our little plan is going to be to head away down towards the crossing point where we were earlier, and we might be very lucky to find something fascinating there. Well, I'm pretty sure we will, but we'll shine the thermal camera into the darkness and see what we can find. I'm hoping, you know, the only two times I've ever seen an aardvark were well after 10 o'clock at night. We've just hit 10 o'clock local time here. Maybe we'll find a Kenyan aardvark as we go. Right, here we go. One last look at the lions. There they are. And on we go. Hello, Andy and Julia in Los Angeles. You want to see, know if lions see differently? I think I heard you correctly. Lions see differently during the night and during the day. Well, they don't see differently in so much as their eyes don't change at all. But I mean, exactly like you suggest, if, similarly to us, they see different shades because there's no light, and because they have a different ratio of what we call rods to cones in their eyes, it's a little bit more, they can see a far greater sort of contrast difference between light and dark, but they can't see the same depth of color that we can, and that's the sacrifice you make for being able to see at night. Where do you want to go? Sorry, I'm just talking to Simon, everyone. We're just going to do a loop. Do you want to go back?
No, I don't know.
Yeah. Sorry, we can have that question again from Justin S. I was just talking to Simon there. You want to know how much colour, if any, a lion can see. Well, apparently lions see in sort of shades of red, green and blue. And so it's pretty much, I think it's pretty monochrome. Other than that, they don't see any kind of yellows and oranges and reds and that sort of thing, and so it's very much the same for us seeing in black and white. But they don't see black and white, and that's key, because of course many of their prey, for example something like an impala or a nyala, or in this case out here an eland or that sort of thing, well, they're just obviously red colored, and to us they're pretty easy to see, but to the lions they disappear in amongst the greens and blues. Now, this is a fairly main road that runs parallel with the Mara River, and we'll turn towards the river shortly and see if we can't find something there. I know there's a road I want to take to the left, loops back towards the river. Right, let's get the thermal camera out there. Graham, what have you spotted? Apparently something off to the left, nothing particularly entertaining. Otherwise, nothing, but if we do see something, we shall be sure to tell you about it. No doubt. Alright, Jamie is back with some lions. I hope, I don't know if it's the same ones. If she's finished her border patrol, any luck it's a new one. So let's go and find out.
Oh, we just can't seem to go anywhere with bumping into lions at the moment. Juma seems to be crawling with them. We've just come across this magnificent male lion. Unfortunately, he's just finished roaring. He's giving us a spectacular display of the lion's vocal prowess. And what an incredible sound that truly is. Now we're going to reposition slightly now that he's decided to settle down, because we might also get to hear the rest of them responding. I have to tell you, after I left the lions just a moment ago, just as David and myself were far enough away, they started roaring as well. He's going to get up. Where are you going to go, boy? Let's stay with him. Male lion on the move is quite a spectacular sight. He is heading south, so very soon he could hit our southern boundary. But let us stick with him while we can. What an amazing night this is. Don't disappear, boy, while I'm turning round. He's stopping every now and again to urine scent mark the various bushes and trees around him. Mostly gwari bushes, which is their standard approach. He's listening now for a response. There it is. There's the response. Just trying to listen to where those... There we go. Never ever gets old. That incredible sound. Okay, on with the engine. And off we go to catch up with him once again. Hopefully we get a couple more opportunities just like that before he goes south. He knows where his buddies are. They've been calling in response. Those of you who have got the dam camera on at the same time, you might even be hearing them as they start to move north. He's going south, splitting up as the Birmingham boys go about their nightly patrols. And this time we get to go with them. How exciting is that? As we trundle along behind our gentleman, while we wait for him to give us another roar, let's go back to Taylor, who's got a little birdie and a little tree.
I hope you all enjoyed that very powerful roar from the Birmingham. I could hear it in the distance and it was so beautiful. Now, as we were driving along looking for insects and other little creatures that we could find, I spotted this lilac-breasted roller who's roosting up in this marula tree, and I just thought it was quite amazing how it's leaning up against that quite thick branch and then it's just perched on a smaller little branch. Now, I don't know if this bird or if birds can see the infrared light. I'm uncertain. It is watching us, but the fact that we have stopped the vehicle and it's quite close to the road as well is possibly why it is looking at us. But I know birds can see ultraviolet light quite well, and that's actually what they look for, especially some of the raptors. They specialize in picking up the UV signatures of urine from the rodents and various other creatures. So it'd be quite interesting to find out if birds can see infrared light. But I don't want to disturb it anymore. I just wanted to quickly show you what the birds do at night and where they roost. And they do go to sleep. They don't spend the entire night feeding. And let's carry on down the road and see what else we've got. What else do we have, everyone? We're trying to move along some different roads, some roads we haven't driven today. And I did spot some bush babies, but they were in the very far distance and I couldn't off-road to get to them, unfortunately. So there's a lot of silver cluster trees around here, and they seem to quite enjoy the silver cluster leaf forest. They've got nice branches for them to bounce around on, so I'm keeping an eye out for some more bush babies. There's lots of them around at the moment. I don't think I've ever seen so many bush babies before. So I'm very excited with the warm weather and the warm months to come as well. And hopefully I'll be able to actually photograph. Oh, we've got more mating insects, and we don't have mating two-spot insect beetles. We've got a different kind. We've got those ground beetles that we saw probably only, what, about 5 minutes ago? Let's see. Iggy, is that fine? I can hear some elephants in the distance too. So we've seen two different types of beetles mating this evening. Here we go. That's very interesting. You can see that one's just got too many legs and too many antennae. It's quite hard to tell from the back that there is actually two beetles there. Remember, everybody, we are live at the moment, and if you have any questions for myself, James, or Jamie, you are welcome to either hashtag Safari Live, or you can even email us, and you can send those through to questions@wildearth.tv, and I cannot wait to hear from you. We're having a fantastic evening out in the bush. It's a lovely adventure. Sorry, everybody, I got distracted by a little cockroach, but let's leave these lustrous couple and let's carry on. Love is definitely in the air tonight, everybody. I feel like I need to start singing. Right, who else have we got hiding in the bushes? So something that Eggsy and I have been chatting about probably for the last half an hour now is if we could find any chameleons. And I thought I actually had some chameleons just a few moments ago, but they turned out to be leaves. So Liz was wondering if we're going to see any. I'm working on it. I'm looking for them right now. So where we need to look is we need to look on the edge of branches. So the sort of trees that are overhanging in the road, those would be good spots for the chameleons to sort of sit on. So that's what I'm looking for. I think we could be a little bit too early, but we're having so much luck this evening. I'm not going to cancel out anything. Well, we're having luck with the insects, but that's fine. Something different and something interesting. Jamie's managed to carry on and find those Birminghams. Let's go back to her.
There's nothing like having a massive male lion walking out of the night towards you. I've shot ahead of him, and we're actually reversing ahead. I'm just making sure we don't go tumbling into twin dams, because somehow I think David might be quite cross with me if I did that. Still got him there, Dave? Well done. Okay, I'm going to watch the road behind me, sort of. It's quite difficult to do this during the day. It's very difficult to do it at night, but it gives you the most spectacular images. Aha. He's going to cut the corner. Okay, let's just go a little bit further. Ooh, nearly drove off the damn wall. That wouldn't have been ideal. Safari Dean, you're wondering if lions ever call at night to stir up the animals hiding in the bushes. And no, I don't think they do. I don't think they want them, when they're hunting them, to be alert to their presence. And I think it's more about, it's all territorial, it's all to do with the dynamics of the different lion prides in the area. It's to do with letting other males know that they're there. The females do the same thing for other female prides, and so on. So you know, Svaridin, that that's why they roar, of course. I know that you know, but here we go. Go catch up with him. He's about to cross over our boundary. Thank you, mister, for giving us that one last show of your incredible ability to roar. It's amazing. Our lions have the most incredibly specially adapted diaphragms and structures. Their ribs are not connected at all, and their larynx muscles, or at least their larynx is a muscle that connects it to their diaphragm, which essentially pulls it down and allows them to produce that incredibly deep bass note. Okay. There is our boundary up ahead, Gowrie Main rapidly approaching as he walks with a slight limp, which is relatively common for a dominant male lion in power. Life is tough. And they usually don't come out unscathed. He hasn't eaten nearly as much as his buddies have. They were full-bellied when we saw them. He is not. Oh. So when I said he was going to disappear across our southern boundary, he had other plans. One of which was to lie down just to the north of our southern boundary. That was very considerate of him. In that case, let's reposition slightly so we've got a better view than the back of his head. Not that there's anything wrong with the back of his head. As we spoke about earlier, they could be in shampoo commercials. My goodness, there are so many moths down my shirt. Ticklish. Oopsie. One more roar for us, buddy. The Birmingham boys are spreading out this evening, making sure that they head to different corners of their territory. Oh, or, you know, collapsing in an exhausted heap on the ground. That works too. Yes, I know, it was a long way you walked. It must have been nearly 500 meters. Right, I'm glad we repositioned. That went very well, didn't it, Dave? And this is pretty much how lions move throughout the evening. Walk a bit, relax. Walk a bit, relax some more. But in this way, you could easily end up walking 20, 25 kilometers tonight. They've got an enormous perimeter to patrol. And I suppose roaring must be quite exhausting work as well. And to the south, his territory stretches all the way towards Mala Mala. And to the west and to the east of us, an equal distance, right towards Kruger on the east, and then back towards Elephant Plains in the west. And I would say that if I had to guess at the size of the Birmingham boys' territory, I'd put it at around 10,000 hectares or so, 8,000, 10,000 hectares. And the frogs are positively deafening, as a gentle reminder to me that I'm going to have to do some brushing up on my frog calls. Some of them, I've noticed, have got a little bit rusty. A lot of what you're hearing now, though, is rain frogs. typically, the road that we're on at the moment, Gowrie Main, when we sit here during the day, we're constantly moving backwards and forwards for vehicles. But right now out here, it feels as though Dave and I are completely alone with this mail line, which we are. Right, if I reposition, mister, are you going to move? What do you think? Probably not, huh? You look relatively comfortable for now. All right, let's try and get a slightly different angle. Perhaps a slightly better one. And let's try and dodge the giant leadwood branches as we do that, so we don't wind up having to change a flat tire in the dark. Wouldn't be the first time I've had to change the flat tire in the dark. Okie dokie, whilst we reposition and shuffle around and get a better view of our lion, let's jump back on board with Taylor and find out where she is and what she's up to.
We've stumbled across a herd of impala. As you can see, they have a little bit jumpy. Some of them got up, and you can see most of them are sitting down and resting, though it's quite a big herd. And they are in the distance, so we've just got a little glimpse over here of a few. It'll be quite interesting to see how they're going to behave. And they actually don't seem too bothered at all. That one's carrying on with its daily activities, it's grooming. And the frogs and everything are chirping away, even having a little scratch. Now, the impala will sleep during the night, but when I say sleep, I don't mean like the Birmingham is doing at the moment. They're sort of just sitting, resting, ruminating, like you can see that female is doing over there. So while you'll have most of the herd sitting down, there'll always be a one, either a male or a female, that will sort of stand up and sort of stand guard and just keep an eye out. Now, these impala aren't out in the open, they're actually in quite a wooded area filled with plenty of silver cluster leaves, trees. And normally what they do is they come out to the open, and I think I was chatting about this last night. But just to recap, it's important for animals that are prey to animals like lions and leopards to move out into the open areas. And that's just sort of a natural defense, because it's easier to spot a predator coming towards you on a big open plain than it is to see the silhouette of something coming towards you when there's lots of trees and shrubs around. So it's quite risky in here. It's a good opportunity for a leopard to come through, because they'll have quite a few different things to hide behind. But I don't see a moon at the moment. It's very dark out here at them. I wish I could actually show you the stars, because that's something very special about Africa as well, is the wonderful stars that we have. Very little light pollution. Munching away. Let's move on from these impala and let's see who else we've got. The slight wind picking up, but hopefully it doesn't blow too strongly. And I haven't seen any more interesting or mating insects. It's like everybody's gone to bed now. Oh, just lots of millipedes on the road. But you'll see me scanning from left to right, just searching the trees for bush babies like I've got over here. It was actually better if I went back. Can you see where I'm looking, Eggsy? Don't jump away. Has it jumped? I don't want to turn the vehicle off in case I think it has. Now I can still see it moving around in the fork of the tree. Hang on, we've got quite an obstructions. And no, hang on, it's jumped, everybody. I have to move. Hang on, there it is. There it is. Quickly, Eggsy, quickly. Go down, go down. There it is. Zoom in there. There we go, everybody. Another lesser bush baby. We are spoiled this evening. Look how quickly they move. Let's see if we're going to see this one jump. Whee! And it's landed over there. This is really testing Eggsy's skills, everybody, and it is gone. I don't know if we're going to get another look at it. See, it's hopping through the trees at the moment. There it goes. Well done, Eggsy. They're still sitting there running along the branch. Now you can definitely see that they can leap up to 2 meters. Wow, that's spectacular. They've got a very good hand and eye coordination, everybody. And they need to be able to have that to catch all those flying insects. Oh no, it's still there. Oh, you jumped towards us. That's kind. Oh, you're coming even closer. You're coming closer. I don't know if you can see it hopping away. There it jumps again, everyone. There it is. Small little critters. Not big. Only about 40 centimeters in length. And that's from head to tail. Let me go forward. So if you were to take your ruler, I'm going to use a ruler for scale tonight. And if you take your ruler and you add 10 more centimeters, so 1/3 of your ruler, then you'll get the length of a bush baby. There it is. Still there. I'm trying to turn the vehicle. Not particularly bothered by us, which I'm quite impressed by. And I'm not going to use the infrared here, just because it's quite difficult to keep up with this bush baby. Look at that long tail. What are you looking for? Something I'd really like to see is a... I need to reposition again. Oh no, you still got it there. Is to see a mother bush baby carry its young sort of in its mouth and jump from tree to tree. I think that must be very impressive to see something like that. You can just sort of see it in the background there in the middle of your screen. And we're actually having quite a long sighting of this bush baby. Normally they're very quick, just a little glimpse. Oi, boing. I always have a good chuckle when they're on the ground and they're bouncing. They remind me very much of the gummy bears. Oh, I found it again. Let's see if we can get another view of it. You are the most accommodating bush baby I've ever come across in my life. But now I say that, no, you're still there. You can just see its eye shine. Well, where did you go? Oh no, it's still on the branch. See it moving away at the back. Now I don't know how you tell whether it's a male or a female. I think that's quite difficult. Wait, where'd you go? Oh, at the bottom. Oi, jumping towards the back. You can just see the branches moving in the distance. Let's see, maybe it comes back again like it has been doing. Moving across, jumping again. Yes, keep jumping to the right, because you're going to come out into the open. There, it's on the ground, on that log. Whee, that was a big one. Now it's gone a bit further to the right. It was in there somewhere, I just saw that. No, it's moved now. It's on the trees at the back, but I don't know if we're gonna see it now. No, no, it's gone. Okay, everybody, it's jumped away from us. Oh no, it's back again. Oh my goodness, it's bizarre behavior, jumping away from us and jumping towards us. Just when I think we're not going to get another view, it surprises us. There it is, on the back trees. You have to go even further past that. Eggsy, to the right, up. It's gone now. Okay, everybody, I don't know if, can you see it? Yes, you can see it, it's moving, there it is. But this bush baby is now jumping very far away from us, and we're not going to off-road to try and keep up with it. But I think that was an incredible sighting of a wonderful little bush baby. So we're gonna head on over to James, who's got a glimmer of the moon.
It sounds like you're having a fantastic time there with the leaping bush babies of Juma. There is the, well, 2/3 moon of Kenya. And it'll be 2/3 where in Juma and 2/3 in the United Kingdom and 2/3 everywhere else, if I'm not mistaken, today. We are still in the southern hemisphere, in case you're wondering about the orientation. Sorry about my audio, everybody. It will be the same orientation here as it is back at Juma. Now, we've stopped here next to our male lion because he has lifted his head up. This is the other brother. Now, I don't know for certain, you know, what their names are yet. We're just getting to grips with that. But if you look at this chap, there we are. There is a lion called Scar in this coalition, apparently. That could be him. If that's not the same as Scarface, who that is inescapably not. He does have quite a few scars on his face. And just to reiterate, everyone, these lions not moving around for exactly the same reason as the Nkuhumas aren't. They've just eaten too much. They're just like you are after a heavy Sunday lunch. Good night. Hello, Robin D. Very good question from you about how a coalition knows where its boundaries are when they take over an area. Robin, I think it's largely from the smell of other lions. Just up ahead, John. Oh, you got him. And what they do is they smell other lions, and that becomes the boundary. So if you take over a territory, this guy looks a bit stiff. He's just having a stretch. Take over territory and they will be bounded by other lions. It's very seldom that, you know, an area is completely devoid of lions. And that's how the territory will stay. But, of course, that can shift. So if that coalition that is on, say, the southern boundary of a lion's territory passes on, then they will probably expand because they cannot smell those old lions around the place. So I think it's largely based on how, you know, the other lions that they smell in the area and how confident they feel about challenging those other lions. I think it probably also has to do with the female territories, because very seldom, in fact, I can't think of an instance where a male's territory will encompass a female's and then half of another one or half of an adjacent female pride's territory. In fact, that's probably more likely to be almost the answer in its entirety. So we know the Birmingham boys dominate two prides, the Styx and the Nkuhumas, and their territory quite neatly fits over the two of them. Now, it's probably slightly bigger, but I don't think they have half another pride's territory. Shall we have a look at the thermal? Dromdrith is quite a nice thermal image, if you like. I didn't mean to sort of tell you what to do. Sandy, sorry, my Skype call broke up as your question came through. I think it was, are these boys the same size as the Birmingham boys? Was that correct? Oh, you say they seem to have much thicker front legs than the Birminghams. Sandy, no, I don't think they have thicker front legs. I think what you're noticing is that they are fuller built. They're really kind of right at the almost the sort of optimum weight that they'll get to, somewhere between 7 and 8 years old. And I think these guys, the very blonde one looked to be about 6 to me, but maybe a bit older. Some of them probably about 7. So they're almost at their full weight, which means that they will be stockier than the Birminghams. I don't think they're any taller. They may be slightly taller, but not much. Their manes will be definitely fuller, and they will be heavier than the Birminghams are at the moment. But the Birminghams, I don't think they're very big lions. In fact, I think they're on the smallish side. But they'll get to about this size when they're 7 or 8 years old. Righty, let's carry on along the road. We might be lucky to find a few more creatures of the Kenyan night. Well, hang on a second, let's just wait and see if he doesn't call. See if he's got a very beautiful voice like his brothers. I've never met a lion with a poor voice, you know, Jean-André. Well, let's leave him to luxuriate in the tickling of the red oat grass. On we go. Jen Ward, you want to know if I've got my blankie? I do not have my blankie. I've got another blankie. There we are. It's actually a seat cover, Jen. This entire car is covered in a rather bizarre green tartan, which we have yet to find the origins of. And I've got the seat cover from my seat over my little exposed leggies. Thank you for your concern. Ooh. Them, Jandre. Ah, we stopped just in time. That was absolutely hopeless timing. All right, everybody, let's go over to, I think it's Taylor. Is it Taylor we're going to? Rebecca? It's Jamie. Let's go across to Jamie.
Another novel experience for us. Let's try and reposition. We've got an elephant herd here in front of us. You'll notice I've got my spotlight on. I'm not shining it at the elephants, but I am using it to make sure that I'm not driving in between the herd, and just to provide me with a little bit of light every now and again to see exactly where they are and to watch their body language, so that I know if it's okay to approach them or if it's not. Guys. And once we stop here, I just keep a gentle eye on what's happening. Okay. And there we go. An elephant herd in the darkness. Might not be the best view we've ever had, but it is fascinating to watch. Well done, Dave. I don't know what you did there. There's nothing quite like sitting in the dark, just listening to elephants feeding. The sounds of their crunching. Amazingly silent creatures, unless you can hear what they're feeding on. You don't hear the sound of their massive bodies moving through the bush. They're like giant ghostly shapes moving in the darkness. This is one of my favorite things to do when I'm out at night. And we do occasionally go out at night, and maybe we go visit friends or whatever it is that we happen to be doing. Especially when you get a full moon, you can sit perfectly placidly in the darkness, surrounded by elephants, and they're absolutely fine at night. In fact, they're usually very nice at night, as long as you sit and you don't bother them at all. You get to enjoy a really spectacular atmosphere. Nothing provides that sense of peace like sitting with an elephant herd, and it's even more pronounced at night. There's a very, very big female there. She's the largest that I've seen so far, and of course they're perfectly aware of our presence. But they don't seem to be terribly bothered. I'm speaking very, very softly, obviously. We don't want to disturb them. Although they are primarily, I suppose you'd refer to them as diurnal animals, but they do continue to feed throughout the night. They don't really have to be worried about much out here. Oh, there's the antenna, in case you're wondering what that giant glowing white stick is. It's the antenna. Why are you suddenly going this way, big girl? Which way are you planning on going? So I'm not shining at her. I'm just illuminating the road in front of me so that I can see what she's up to. And if she went across the road to feed, yeah, she did. She did just go across the road to feed. Because it's dark and because I can't see, I've been keeping a relatively safe, or definitely a safe distance, a relatively large distance between myself and the elephant, just to make sure that we don't get ourselves into any trouble. And what a special way to spend an evening. This entire experience has been mind-boggling. I'm hoping that they might decide to come a little bit closer if we sit nice and still and give us a slightly better view. It's always best to let the elephants approach you. I keep glancing down at my monitor because I can't see exactly what Dave is seeing. And I'm just ever so slightly dropping the spotlight onto the ground to try and make sure I know where they all are. Here you go, Gracie. He's 9 years old. I know that elephants are one of Gracie's absolute favorite animals. And Gracie says, yay, elephants at night. So I'm glad that we could spend a little bit of time with elephants for you, Gracie. I'm going to try. Actually, I'm not going to reposition for now. I'm just going to make the most of this sighting and try and listen to whatever it is they are up to. As they gently browse. I can't reposition right now, I don't think. I'll keep that little bit of light on. Or is that light making your life more difficult, Dave?
Better.
Okay. And I'm sure that they are incredibly happy that we've had as much rain as we have had, and that very soon the bush will start to go a little bit greener. They'll have something more exciting to snack on than the bits of bark that they've been surviving on over the last few months. For now, though, this female is very focused on digging something up out of the ground. Using those massive feet and trunk in conjunction. Aha! There's something that I've been very much on the lookout, apart from elephants. Taylor's got something definitely much smaller and probably better at jumping.
I could do a happy dance, everybody! I've finally found my frog. Well, I think that this is actually a little toad that we're looking at. I remember finding one many months ago and photographing it. Now, it's quite small. It's probably the size of a South African 5-rand coin. I'm trying to think what else I could give it a size reference. So if you take your index finger and your thumb and you make a circle with it, and you look in that circle, that is pretty much the size of this toad over here. So if you can all take a screenshot of it for me, Eggsy's going to zoom in now, so I could please look for it a little bit later this evening. Now, amphibians are my favorite thing in the whole wide world. I love them. Them and elephants and hyenas. They are what I live for. So it'll be quite interesting to see what this little chap is. And I have a beautiful big frog book back in my room, and this will be the first thing that I look for, because I do actually have a photo of it, but it'd be nice to have a photo of this one. And you can see it's got its mouth slightly gaped. I'm not entirely sure what it's doing. It's not making any noises at all. It's a very quiet frog, And also doesn't seem to be too bothered by us. I thought it was going to hop into the water as we arrived, but thankfully it did not. You know what you are doing? And normally they would be sitting here calling away, hoping to entice or serenade a lovely lady. But this toad seems to be the only one here. There doesn't seem to be anyone else around. You can see, very quiet. Probably singing, I'm Mr. Lonely, I have nobody, I'm all on my own. Or something along those lines. But I'm so happy I spotted the little frogs, this toad, sorry, eyeshine, from the road. We are covered in spider webs, everybody, as well. Everywhere we've been driving, we keep taking out spider webs, unfortunately. Fantastic. I wish this little one would give us a call. Then it would also make it much easier for me to try and figure out who this amphibious creature is. Right, fantastic. Let's see if I can find anybody else, everyone. We're going to move away from this amphibian now, and we're going to see what else we can find. Maybe we can find some more. Just quickly double checking. Nope, it is Mr. Lonely. Right, now let me just quickly reverse out of here and make sure that I don't drive into the watering hole, just to get back onto the road. And we're back onto the road. I'm not sure entirely where I am either. It's a lot more difficult trying to navigate at night, but it turned out to be a very productive little road, and doesn't look like it's been driven in a while. Definitely not since the rains. I hope it is indeed a road and it isn't just some erosion that's been washed away. I don't think it is. It's maybe just an old road that is not favored by the rangers in this area. So something that we haven't seen yet are fireflies. And Erica wants to know, do we have any bioluminescent creatures? Now Erica, we've got the fireflies, which emit a wonderful little chemical that allows them to glimmer at night time. Other than that, I'm not sure if we've got anything else. I think it is just the fireflies, but if I am incorrect, you're welcome to let me know and educate me by either using the hashtag on Twitter. You can do hashtag Safari Life, or you can also email us at questions@wildearth.tv. Who else have we got? What? This is very bumpy, this little road that we seem to have stumbled across. Poor Eggsy is holding on for absolute dear life. Now we're waiting for the chameleons, everyone. James has got another hippo. Head to him while I look for some chameleons.
We have no... Okay, we're live, everybody. Right, sorry about that. We just lost our communications briefly with the final control. Look at that very, very pretty picture going on there. A hippopotamus standing beneath a fascinating tree called Balanites aegyptica. And I think that's called a desert date in English. Now, of course, many of you will know of the Balanites tree on Juma. That's Balanites mogami, the torchwood. And that tree that we've just seen there is one of the most iconic trees of this particular part of the world. Dotted across the clearings. This is a wonderful hippo sighting. We thought this hippo would move off. Many of them have moved off away from us. But this one is feeding, sort of, and then listening every time I exclaim its magnificence. That's fantastic. Look at that. Now, you cannot believe that those great big chomping teeth have any usefulness to a grazing animal. And they don't really, except when they're defending their territory. Or their babies from crocodile attack, perhaps.
That hippo is now slightly suspicious of what it feels is probably a slight tingling in the eye, but it can't really see what it is that's doing that. And they've hardly got incisors of teeth. It's basically their lips that they use to pick those great big swathes of grass. That's very cool. And I'm just going to quickly send a message to the final control via you that I cannot hear them at all. I'm going to close down the call and try and redo it. Just amazing. That hippo got no idea. I'm afraid I've lost the final control completely, so I can't talk to Rebecca. I'll try and WhatsApp Jerry. Now, of course, the point of my telling you all of this, everybody, is so that they can actually hear me. There we go. Where we've got Jerry back. Hello, Jerry. Now, what's interesting, are we still alive, Rebecca? No, we're still alive. That's wonderful. Now, an hippopotamus, unlike its rather large equivalent, the white rhinoceros, doesn't eat nearly as much food. Apparently, almost half to two-thirds of what you'd expect for an animal like this. So a hippo, at least a big white rhino, will eat about 40 kilograms of this kind of grass a day. And a hippopotamus, well, I've read things as small as 8 kilos, and it might be up to sort of 20, but it's definitely far less than a rhino. And I think that's because they don't do anything in the day. They just lie in the water, wallowing about the place. They don't actually have to hold their whole mass. Oh, Jesus, we had an amazing time with the bush babies at Juma. There's another one now with Jamie.
Yay! One of my favorite nocturnal animals to look at. A little bush baby who's been giving us the most incredible demonstration of its jumping skills, hasn't it, Dave? We've been chasing it backwards all the way down Gowrie, Maine. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. And he's testing my spotlighting. I've lost it. I've lost it. Oh, there it is. Jeepers. Oh, no. Oh, no. Where'd it go? I can't see it anymore, Dave. How did we manage to stay with it for that long and now we lose it? We've been reversing all the way down Gowrie Bay, not chasing, but keeping up with this. Ha ha, I got you. With this little bush baby. Okay, where are you going to go from there? Now, the name bush baby, to answer Fran's question. Okay. Don't go. We're going to go backwards a bit. Next thing I'm going to find myself in the middle of that elephant herd again. I better be careful. Where'd you go? Aha, I see you. Okay, I'm going to answer Fran's question in a second. So Fran would like to know whether or not a bush baby makes a call. And Fran, the answer to that is actually the reason behind the name, oh my goodness, little thing, bush baby. Because particularly the greater bush baby, which is the greater Galago, one that we don't see, that I've never seen here, but you do see up in the sort of northern parts around Pufuri. There he goes, in the middle of my spotlight there. And he's in the Marula tree. He's keeping Dave guessing. There he is. The greater Galago, the greater bush baby, makes a cry that sounds like a crying baby. Hence the name bush baby. Sound. Really, it really sounds like that. It sounds like a crying baby. I've got it again, but I've lost it again. Where'd it go? Sorry, Dave, I've lost it. No, there it is. It is in the middle of my spotlight. It's just not looking at us right now. Oh, there's two. Okay, this little one's going left again. Okay. Oh, there it is. I think this might spell the end of our bush baby sighting. Okay. So our lesser bush babies are a little bit quieter than the greater bush babies. They don't make as much noise as these do. They can make a sort of a chirping, hissing sound, especially when they cross with each other. They sort of swell up and get very cross. There's one there, Dave, in the middle of my spotlight, but at the back. I don't know if you can see it at all. And I can't... Yes, there you go. I can see the eyes shining. There you go. Well done. I can see you, little thing. Just your eyes at the moment. Glowing back a bright red colour. There's nothing that looks quite like the eyes of a bush baby. Mandinga, you would like to know what the estimated population of bush babies is, would be within the Kruger. And that's a really, really difficult question for me to answer. I read one study that in thick bush willow woodland, they encountered 500 per square kilometre. That's a massive, massive number. And that, I think, was a slight overestimate of that particular study. I don't know the answer to that. If I had to guess, I would say a good 100,000 or so. Possibly even more. There are lots and lots of lesser bush babies. A smaller number of, there's two of them there, actually. But I'm just trying to find a clear view for Dave. Come on. Little bush babies, come a bit closer. I do see them, but they're very, very difficult to see and they're very difficult to film. They do live in little family groups. They all sort of nest together. And they'll often go out foraging. They forage alone, but they will occasionally meet up with another member of their family group. They're not strictly territorial, though. So it's not like they are defensive if they ever meet a stranger or strange bush baby. They just maybe inflate a little bit. Oh, wow. I'm going to reposition. I've got something to show you. That is so cool. Bear with me one moment, it's going to totally be worth it. Might not be the best view sight I've ever encountered, but it's still an awesome view. How's that, Dave? Cool. The moon on its way up. How's that for colour? Bright orange. And as the moon rises on evenings like this evening, especially in winter's months, or after the dry season, the amount of dust and atmosphere gives it that orangey colour. Let's head across to Taylor and see what she's up to.
Hang on, everybody. Before I get talking too much, I've just spotted a white-tailed mongoose, and now it was racing off into the distance, so we are trying to just spot it again. Where? Oh, there it's. My goodness. Can you get it? It was hiding in a log for us very nicely, but unfortunately it's now shy and has moved off. Still in the distance. Let me see if we can get it again. Maybe it stops at the next log. There it is. No, I don't know if we're going to see it again. I'm afraid it's disappearing. Ah, okay. Well, we tried, everybody, to see where it goes. Did you see it? It's disappearing to the left. No, it's gone. Okay. Well, we tried, everybody. We did have a very nice white-tailed mongoose, and unfortunately, they are very, very secretive creatures, and that was the largest species of mongoose that we see in this area. Now, everyone, I hope that you enjoyed the show this evening. It's been full of surprises and lots of adventures, and I hope you're looking forward to joining us tomorrow afternoon as we do another safari marathon. But I'm going to head off and curl up in my bed, though before I do that, I've got lots of research to do. And I'll get back to you on some of those answers tomorrow. So from myself, Taylor, I hope you have a lovely evening. And Eggsy, I'm sure you want to give one last goodbye. And we'll hopefully see you tomorrow afternoon. Don't forget to tune in.
After a marathon game drive, I've had an absolute ball. And I think it's almost time for us to say a goodbye and a farewell to all of you. I do hope you've enjoyed yourselves. It's been spectacular from our side. Dave and I have had one of the most memorable experiences I think, well, I know I've ever had in the bush. And Dave says likewise. So from myself and Dave, a big thank you to Dave for all of his amazing work. He's done some spectacular stuff this evening. Thanks, Dave. And to our wonderful directors in Final Control, especially Rebecca for keeping us under control, and to all of you for joining us. Have a wonderful time wherever you are in the world. We'll catch up with you tomorrow on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Right, everybody, that's going to be it from us here in the Mara Triangle, as well as the Sabi Sunt down in sunny South Africa. It's been a real joy to bring this to you, and I'm really looking forward to the next 4 nights or so. Hopefully those lions will get off their bottoms and do something useful. I'm sure the Nkuhumas will as well. A big thank you to Jandre. Thank you, Jandre, for your efforts. A big thank you to Rebecca and Jerry and Louise in the Final Control, with Alex, the Russian, who apparently looked miserable from beginning to end, but that's pretty normal. And a big thanks to Graham and Emily, they're here, and to Jamie and Taylor and the big cameraman team down on the ground there in Johannesburg. We will see you tomorrow in the afternoon, 3 o'clock this side, 4 o'clock, 4 o'clock this side, 3 o'clock that side, a little bit tired. We'll see you then. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.